Thanks very much, Annette. I'm very proud to be here tonight because I believe this is a very historic occasion that the GAA has gone from the club room into a local library and got the local people in just to tell our story and what we can do in relation to health and well-being. And there's one publication which the GAA has recently, and if I can remember the name of it, because I think Jeanette wrote it down for me, but I can't really read or write. It's called Gambling and Sport Considerations for the GAA. It was published last year, 2014. And its main aim is to assist the GAA, its players and its members in dealing and identifying problem gambling and to encourage those who may have or may be experiencing a difficulty to seek support and assistance. And it also highlights the strict rules and regulations and the laws of the land in relation to gambling and all that type of thing. So I'd urge anyone to look at the GAA website and download that for their club. Again, it's called Gambling and Sport Considerations for the GAA. I'm not going to go on all night long. Every club in the county should have a health and safety subcommittee at this stage. And I think tonight could be the catalyst for people to realise, yes, we need them. Because when we look at a superstar like Oisín McConville, and that's no exaggeration because I've watched him many a time grace the football field. I think a forward of renown. I think he made history in, I think he got into the Hall of Fame there for the 124 Ulster players. An All-Ireland medal winner, no mean achievement. I think it's sick when you're talking about it. I think it's six Ulster titles. Maybe I'm wrong, there's a few more. And Cross Madeleine, where do you go, club champions? You know, and then you wonder, how can a man like him come to Carlow to speak about something other than sport? I think it's absolutely fantastic that Oisin would bear his soul to us tonight. And maybe we could learn from the experiences that Oisin has and the support that we can get. Because Oisin, straight away, he did not refuse, I'd be glad to come. I know I passed on a number to Jeanette, and straight away, it wasn't a refusal, I might or I mightn't, sorry I'm busy, I'd be delighted. Because he sees this himself as another way of getting that message out there. And he's more adept and more professional in delivering that message. So I'm with great pride, Carlow GAA, to be associated with someone like Oisin, and to hand over to Oisin and let us know what it's all about.
Thanks very much. I had no problem with that when Jeanette rang me and asked me if I would come up. No problem. But I'm going to tell a quick story. It's nothing to do with gambling. It's a little bit to do with football. But as Benny says, we won an All-Ireland title in 2002. It was the only title we've ever won. Pat Spillane calls us the famous Armagh one in a row team. But as part of winning this Sam Maguire, you take around the different clubs and schools, and we take it around lots of clubs and schools. The last school I had to take it to was my own school, St. Patrick's Primary School across Midland. 450 kids, every single one of them wanted to ask a question. It was about 1:30 on a Friday afternoon. I'd answered 449 questions. And there was a wee boy Liam at the front who had his hand up for an hour and he kept holding it up with one hand, holding it up with the other. And I deliberately hadn't went to Liam because even at 7 years of age, he was a smart ass. And eventually, I turned to the headmaster and said, I think that's every headmaster. And he says, no, what about we Liam at the front? So I went to Liam and I said, Liam, have you a question to ask? And he says, yes, Oshie, what time are you leaving at? Because we PE at 2:00. So whenever I get in front of a microphone now, I try and keep it as short and as sweet as possible. And I would love to be down here talking, shooting the breeze about football or sport in general, but I'm here to talk about something else, and I'm here to talk, and I'm going to put it in context for you before I start about why I would come and why I would talk about I suppose my experiences And I suppose all our mental well-being and mental health. And one of the reasons is last year we played a club match, and also a club match, we were beaten by a team called Oma. And on the way home on the bus, actually during the first minute of the game, we had a wee lad called Kerry Carr, and he tore his hamstring. And he was brought off the field, and he got ice, and he got physio. And 3 days later, he got a scan. He got more physio, he got rehab, and he got walked back onto the field in the next 6 weeks or 2 months. Perfect, hamstring perfect. We also had a young fellow on that bus, and it was a very dark night. It was November, it was a very dark night, it was raining, and we arrived back at the club, and I knew that there was one fellow on that bus who was, and the best way I could describe it was that he was going through severe mental health trauma. And he got off the bus, and I said, I'm going to follow him to his house, because I knew he was going to his house on his own. But I was that pissed off, because we were after being beaten, that I said, no, I'll leave until tomorrow. And I woke up the next morning, it was even worse for him. And I went to Belfast that night, because Tony Adams was talking, and he's, no, don't know who Tony Adams is, he's former Arsenal and England captain. And he was talking about, again, about mental health, about his struggle with alcohol, how he was arrested. You know, a very interesting story for anybody who has or would like to read his book. But during the talk he was having, he broke down crying. It was a very emotional night, because I was actually speaking the same night myself, and I felt emotional. It was probably different reasons, because we have to get beat the next day, but I didn't mention that. But Tony Adams broke down, and the first person I thought about was the young fella we had on the bus that night. And the young fella who went home on his own and had spent 2 days in the house on his own. I knew he had. And when I got home that night, it was too late to go to him. And I got up the next morning, it was the first thing in my head, and I went to him. And the only thing I can say is, and this is not to sound too dramatic about it, but I'm glad I didn't leave it for another day. And for me, that's the difference between somebody with a physical injury and somebody with a mental illness. Now that lad got help and is doing really, really well now. For me, my experience started at 14 years of age. My father used to do a bet on a Saturday, like I suppose a lot of people do. And he would have left it at that. And I used to be the person who used to take the bet slip down, and I used to put it behind the counter, get the bet slip back, hand it to my father, and that was where it started and ended for me. At 14 years of age, I said I was going to give it a go. And first time I had a bet, I honestly don't remember if the horse won or lost. But I remember being in the bookies and feeling at home. And I remember thinking, I like it in here. I feel as if I belong. And the strange thing about that was that anybody who's into bookmakers now will notice that they're pretty plush surroundings. You know, you've got the chairs and the sofas, you've got multiple screens, you get tea, coffee, biscuits. This was a smoke-filled room at the back of a pub. But again, it was somewhere where I felt at home. There was guys over in this corner who were having a 1 euro or a 2 euro bet, and there was the hay rollers over in this corner who were taking a wad of money out of their pocket. I wanted to be like them. And I suppose, if I'm truthful, at 10, 11, 12, 13 years of age, I was doing things in the football field that not a lot of other people were doing, especially people my age. And when I say that, I mean, as far as practice goes, I was at every single training session, under 12, under 14, under 16, minors, seniors, even if it was only kicking the ball back from behind the goals. I was constantly at that. At 14 years of age, that changed for me. And that one single goal changed. And the one thing, I suppose, that I wanted, when I grew up in a wee small village across the land during the Troubles, all I wanted to be was the best Gaelic footballer I could be. At 14 years of age, that changed for me. I wanted to be the best gambler I could be. And I still played football all right, but gambling was my number one. And I didn't know it at the time, but at 14 years of age, I was addicted instantly. And I think the big thing about at 14 years of age, I might have only gambled twice maybe when I was 14. Maybe gambled 5 or 6 times when I was 15. Maybe gambled once a month when I was 16. 17, I was gambling every single day with every penny I had, begging, borrowing, stealing, all to get the money. And I think the thing about where I grew up, this is a very small village. Well, it's a very small town, let's just say. There's lots of pubs. There was two big bookmakers at the time. I used to go into one particular bookmaker. And after a while, the bookmaker said to me that I needed to take it a little bit easy, that it could turn into a problem for me. Now, I don't know if that would happen in any bookmakers today, but my reaction to that was not, he's got a point. My reaction to that was, I'm never going into that bookies again. So from then on, I used to gamble in Newry or the Dock or anywhere I could get away from the hometown. And my gambling was developing and other things were suffering. Football was suffering for number one. But the other thing was suffering was that I was becoming isolated at 17, 18, 19 years of age. Because if my friends were going out on a Friday, Saturday or Sunday night, I wasn't going out. And when they asked me to go out, I was constantly telling them no. And if you tell people no enough times, eventually it'll go away. So I was finding myself isolated. And the reason why I was isolated was that two reasons. First reason was that normally I didn't have any money to go out because I'd gamble it. And even if I had, I'd be saving it to gamble the next day. And I suppose for me, you know, the other things were suffering as a result of the fact that I was being isolated was that I didn't have any emotions. My emotions were stunted. And when I talk tonight about what happened to me during gambling, one of the things I talk about a lot is the financial implications. Because gambling left me financially bankrupt, emotionally bankrupt. No self-respect, no self-esteem, no integrity. Relationships in shatter. The last thing I had to lose, emotions gone. Last thing I had to lose was my family. And I just about clung on to them. Because I had, for 16 years, I had lied to them. And during those 16 years, I suppose I went through a lot of things. In 1989, my father passed away after suffering a 6-month illness. And my father was old school. And he provided for the family. But there was no such thing as, you know, I love you or any of that, or hugs or anything like that. Just wasn't done in our house, and that was plain and simple, and that was fine because that's what I grew up with. And I suppose my father was very ill for 6 months, and I'll be honest with you, he was in hospital for 6 months, and I very rarely went to see him because I was either gambling. And the other thing about not going to see him was that I knew a lot of my family would be around, and I didn't want to get sucked into sitting down and talking to my family. Or talking to my father, because I didn't want them looking into my eyes and seeing the person I've become. I didn't want them to know that I was a compulsive gambler. And as my father started to get worse, the more I would stay away, because the more family members would be there. And I don't take any pride in saying that. In fact, I'm ashamed talking about that out loud. We played probably the biggest game of my life was in 1989. We won an Ulster title after 19 years in the wilderness. And we know when we played Meath in the Northern Ireland semi-final. And my father was very ill, and I didn't travel with the team on the day before, but I got a lift down that night. Strange thing about not traveling with the team was that was somebody else's decision, that wasn't my decision. If I had my decision, I would have been away with the team. And I'd seen my father that day, and I'd been took down to the hotel the night before the game. Got up the next day, we played the game. We were beaten immediately after the game. My cousin come rushing into the dressing room, told me not to get changed, just to get in his car, and we go up the road. Into the car, there was a guard escort sitting outside, took us right to the border, went straight to the hospital. My father wasn't dead, he was just clinging on. But a couple of emotions for me on the way up that road. The first one was, you know, if people only knew, like, people were feeling sorry for me because I was getting rushed away, and yet I hadn't really, like, I had ample opportunities to go and see him, and I didn't see him. But another overriding emotion was that when I go into the hospital, I'm gonna give my father a hug and I'm gonna tell him I love him. And I swore to myself the whole way up the road that I was gonna do that. But being a compulsive gambler, I'm also a compulsive liar. So when I got up there, my father was unconscious and never regained consciousness. And I told myself that was the reason why I didn't give him a hug and why I didn't tell him I loved him, even though he probably could have heard. But I was incapable of that because I was void of all those emotions. He died on the Wednesday, and the only thing I could think about on the Wednesday was, when am I going to get my next bet? And on the Thursday and the Friday, I couldn't get away. And on the Saturday, he was buried, and I thought, I'll go straight after this. But I couldn't, we were involved in family stuff. But on the Sunday, I got away, and I gambled. And my gambling completely spiraled out of control after that. Because I couldn't deal with that. I wasn't dealing with those emotions that everybody else. I didn't cry my father died. I was sad, yeah, I was sad. But I couldn't actually express that. And as I say, I don't say that lightly. You know, I don't come down here and I don't say that lightly. It's not something that rolls off the tongue. But it's a realization for me. Because when I talk about my addiction and I talk about where it took me, I have to realize where it took me. And stuff like this, believe it or not, is helpful for me. Because it resonates with me just exactly where I was at that time. And people talk about football around that time and how you keep playing football and, you know, how do you concentrate on football. Football was just an outlet for me at that time. Football was the only other place where I felt comfortable. Football was the only other place where I felt as if I could express myself, there in the boogies. When I went to school, in a grammar school in Newry, on a bus at 11 years of age, with lots of other people from my town, I didn't feel as if I belonged. The only time I felt as if I belonged in school was in PE, because I was able to express myself, and I was on a level, at least with them, if not above them. But when I was in class, I wasn't as capable as other kids. I'm not saying that so people feel sorry for me, I just wasn't as capable as them, and that was it. I was in the school that I shouldn't have been in, and I was probably there because I played football. And I suppose that started to get in on me at a very early age. And people talk about, you know, how do you keep expressing yourself in football? I mean, as I say, that was the only place where I felt as if, you know, I belonged outside. And when I went to training and I left my phone in the car on a Tuesday or Thursday night, that was relief for me. Because I knew for those 2 hours or whatever it was, I didn't have to gamble. Because my gambling started with, I got a buzz out of winning. Then I got a buzz out of just putting on the bet. Then, believe it or not, there was a buzz out of putting on the bet, winning and losing. And then there was no buzz at all. And for 6 years, there was no buzz in my gambling. None whatsoever. But I felt every day that I had to gamble. There was something pulling me that I felt. I was in the midst of an addiction. And I felt as if I had to go every day. Not just that I wanted to, or I wanted to claw all that money back, but regardless of what my day consisted of, that I would have to end up in the boogies. And I suppose people always talk to me about trying to understand gambling, because of all the addictions, it probably is the hardest to understand, because there's no substance involved. You talk about drink, people understand it. You talk about drugs, people understand it. And I suppose the best way I can describe it so that people understand is that we see very vivid images on television of people who are strung out in drugs, heroin or whatever. And every time I put that bet on, I felt like I was getting a hit. And when you see those guys on TV who are strung out, and they just need one hit, my hip was putting on a bet. And when I put that on, I could actually feel relief in my body. And I knew 9 times out of 10, the bet I done was gonna lose. But But that didn't bother me. I just wanted to. I was always chasing the dream. I'm only talking about being a compulsive layer, being a compulsive gambler and a compulsive layer. I wasn't just laying to the people around me, I had just begun to lay to myself. And I began to believe those lays. And I told myself that I would, the next big hit I got, the next big win I got, that I would go and I would pay off all those debts. And that not only would that sort out my debt problem, but I'd start to open up to people. I'd start to tell them where I was. And I had lots of losses, but I had also wins. I had also opportunities to get myself out of the trouble that I was in. But I chose not to, because I was a compulsive gambler. And nothing was ever good enough for me. I had to go again and again and again and again until I lost that. And I knew there was inevitability about what I was doing. But I couldn't stop it. And actually, when I voice that out loud, and when I say that out loud to you people, hugely, I'm sure loads of intelligent people here who are thinking, Jesus, you know, could you not just cop on? You know what? It's the last thing you'll hear whenever you go in and you're dealing with addiction or you go into treatment. But there's a lot in that. There's a lot in cop on. You know, but I didn't have that cop on. And I didn't have the structures around me to help me get away from this. And I suppose when people talk about, you know, the football end of things, one of the things they'll say about gambling, and probably one of the reasons why it's such a widespread problem, is that gambling doesn't affect you physically. And I suppose, I think it was maybe the year 2001, and we were going quite wild football-wise, and we had a dietitian in, and she said I was one of the players that needed to put on a stone in weight in 6 weeks because I wasn't taking the tackle maybe as well as some of the rest of the boys and different things like that. She came back in 6 weeks and actually lost a stone because of the simple fact that there was no self-care anymore. Like, I was living away from home and I wasn't coming home that often. My mother probably sees more of me now when my wife's away or something. I call back for dinner or something like that on a Thursday or Friday or whatever it is. But the point I'm trying to make is that it was affecting me physically. I wasn't sleeping. It was months where I just could, well, I could go to bed. I was living in a house in Cavan. I'd taken a lease in a pub in Cavan. And I was laying in a bed in Cavan. There was never any bed clothes on the bed. There was nothing ever in the house. There was nothing ever in the fridge. There was electricity. That was it. There was never any heat in it. And I spent two winters in that house. And I never felt the cold. I never felt tired. I'm very sure I looked tired, but I never felt tired. I physically couldn't sleep for the reasons that people were chasing me for money. I knew I couldn't get my hands on it. I was embarrassed. I was ashamed. And the big thing for me was that I thought it was a weakness to ask for help. I thought that would be the biggest weakness I could ever show. I know different now, but at that time, because I wasn't sharing it with anybody, and when I say nobody, I mean absolutely nobody. And I had two friends in particular who I played football with from I was 6 or 7 years of age, and they constantly were on to me, constantly badgering me about, did I have an issue? Was there something going on? Why do they always need to borrow money off them? And I had a great capacity to lay and fob them off and push people away. And I did that with my family as well. I did it with everybody who was close to me and pushed them away because I didn't want anybody finding out. And a great capacity to make up lays of it. Like, I must have lost my bank card 100 times, must have lost my checkbook 100 times, all those things. I was bouncing checks on my own brother who was a business in town. Again, when I say all this stuff out loud, there's nothing in that that I'm proud of. But that's where I was. And that's the desperation I was in. I would have done anything to get money to get that bet on. Anything. Because I was in the midst of an addiction. And I'll tell this story, and the reason why I'm going to tell it is, I'm probably going on a bit, but the reason why I'm going to tell it is that I don't do that much travelling on my own, as far as playing on my own, but recently I've had to do a little bit more of it, because I'm doing a little bit of stuff in England. But in 2003, I think, I had to get a back operation, and there's nobody in Ireland done it, and I went to a place called a hospital in Luton, and I got an operation done. Now, the operation, I actually had to check with me, the operation cost £10,000, but luckily enough it was made out to the hospital, not to me or a blank or anything like that. But anyway, arrived over, I was on my own, arrived over, got the operation done. I couldn't fly the same day, but I wasn't allowed to stay in the hospital, so I was booked into a hotel in Luton, which was a couple of miles away from the hospital. And I was going past in the actual town of Luton, I went past the bookies, and the taxman literally pulled up maybe half a mile away, and I had this in my head. I said, like, I literally could barely walk. In fact, the taxi man actually carried my bag in, and somebody carried the bag upstairs, and I get in, and I just lay in the bed. But in my head I was thinking, I passed the boogies there, a few quid in my pocket, I'll take a run up, I don't feel too bad. And I sort of convinced myself that I didn't feel too bad. So I walked up to the boogies, and I was spending a lot of money, well, whatever money I had, I didn't have that much, probably a couple of £100. I was spending the money, and I was down to my last 15 quid. And I knew the next morning that exactly it was 15 quid to the last of the taxi man. £15 from the hotel I was staying in to Luton Airport to get the flight the next morning, 7:30. And I'd spent all my money apart from 15 quid, and I was sitting in the boogies, and I was thinking, this is the only way I can get all this money back. What to do? And I literally must have sat there and thought about it for half an hour, maybe an hour. And eventually I put 15 quid on a horse, and the horse had beaten. I walked back to the hotel, and I had no money to have anything to eat. Just got into bed and I tried to sleep. And literally I had to get up the next morning at 3:30 because I thought a couple of hours, it's gonna be a couple of hours walk, because it was over 7 miles to the airport. It's gonna be a couple of hours walk. I had a bag on my shoulder. I'm about to get a back operation. That money was clubbed together from people who within the county, as you know happens, from people within the county who were supporting us at the time and backing us financially. And I was walking out that road, and I was actually due a carriageway, so I actually had a walk in the grass verge. And halfway out, or maybe a little bit more out the airport, I realised, I'm not going to make this, I'm going to have to start running. And I literally had to start running with a bag on my shoulder after a back operation, and eventually I got there and I made the flight and got home. And the reason why I want to tell that story is that 6 months after I came out of treatment, I had to go back to get the exact same thing done. And it was the same guy who had arranged it. He basically looked back through his notes, and he'd organised the exact same way. So the flights were the exact same time, the hospital, the operation was the exact same time, the airport, the hotel was the exact same. I made the same trip in, past the boogies, looked at the boogies on the way back in, and I thought, if I have a bet now, nobody'd ever know. Because that's still where I was as a person. That even 6 months down the lane after being in treatment, that I still had that fleeting thought through my head. That for one instance in my head I thought, I could get away with that. And obviously, I went into the hotel, and I have a couple of people who I surrounded myself with at that stage, good people. And I suppose I rang one of them when I got into the hotel, and I was so ashamed of myself for even thinking it. Not alone, you know, I wouldn't even walk down the road, I wouldn't even walk down past it. And that's the way I was for a long time, that I couldn't even physically walk past the boogies. Because I didn't trust myself enough. And when I got out and I started walking, my sister used to look after all my finances. So every day, every week I work, come home with whatever, I hand her the wages and she paid off alone, because I just continue on the story, because no way I'm rabbiting on a bit, but towards the end of my gambling, I realised that I was going to need one big bet to get myself out of the hole that I was in. So I got a loan guarantor by a local businessman and went to credit union. I got £20,000 out and went and had a £20,000 bet in the boobies. And I had it in a horse 4-1. I thought if I win £100,000, it'd get me out of the trouble that I'm in. And the horse was beaten. And by the way, in case anybody thinks I couldn't get £20,000 on a horse, because it would be hard enough to get on most bookmakers, but I since have been told by people who work within the bookie industry that I was one of the people who could have got whatever money they wanted, and whatever bookies or whatever one of their bookies that I wanted, because they knew they were going to get it back. And that's exactly what the words to me was. But anyhow, had the bet lost, get into the car, rummaged around and got 7-8 euro together, back in. And my insanity, honestly, my insanity at that stage was that I firmly believed that I was going to turn that 7 or 8 euro into all that money that I'd lost. And I lost that, obviously, and got into the car and drove home. And when I was home, all I could think about the way I drove was, what can I do? I couldn't jump on a plane because I couldn't afford it. Would I drive the car into a wall? Would I drive it into a lake? Or what would I do? And I just kept driving, and eventually I got home. And I had no intention whatsoever of holding up the white flag or saying that was the end of my gambling, because I always felt as if I had one more bet in me, always. I went home, and my brother and sister were there, and they've moved out of home, they've married, kids, all that, and my mother's usually there, especially at that time. I think it was 5:30 in the evening, and I get into the house, and I broke down, and I started crying. I hadn't cried for 16 years, because I didn't have any emotions, and eventually when I stopped crying, I started to tell them. And when you haven't cried for 16 years, it takes a while to stop, believe me. But eventually when I did stop, I started telling them exactly where I was at. And I suppose the most difficult thing for me was, having been a compulsive liar and a compulsive gambler for so long, was to actually tell them everything. So in actual fact, what I was giving them was little snippets of what was going on. The horrendous stuff I sort of kept, but eventually over the next couple of days, I started to talk about them, started to tell them about them. And they said that the next thing I was going to have to do was tell my mother. And I dreaded that day, because my mother's everything to me, and she's getting on even at that stage. And she's 80 now soon, and she can still buy and sell me in every capacity, but. When I had to tell her, I dreaded telling her, because I thought, it's going to kill her, it's going to break her, she's not going to be fit to deal with it. And when I told her, she just threw her arms around me and said that this could be the start of the rest of my life. And she was right. My last bet was the 12th of October 2005, so that was the day before my 30th birthday. And from that day, I suppose my life has changed dramatically. And it wasn't an instant change, it wasn't like a light switch or anything like that. I didn't have that. When people talk about, you know, I probably was as low as I could go, but people talk about that light bulb moment where it switches on and they start to, you know, instantly deal with it and get their head around what was after happening. Like, I was still in shock. I didn't really know what addiction was. I hadn't a clue. When somebody mentioned addiction to me, before, I used to think of the guy who was laying on the park bench with a brown bag. And that was the image that I had in my head. And you know what? Even when I went into treatment, I was in a treatment centre, and went into a treatment centre in Galway. I actually met Sister Concilio herself. My brother-in-law took me to meet Sister Concilio. And she said to me, to my face, she said I was one of the worst cases she'd ever seen. I walked into her facility in Galway. I thought, Jesus, if I'm the worst case she's ever seen, I must be in a bad way. So I was looking around me and I was seeing guys who were, I was in a bed, I was in a room with six people, and four of them were getting sick in the buckets beside the bed. They were in for drink problems, and I was thinking, geez, I'm not that bad. I don't belong here. And slowly but surely over the next couple of weeks, I could see these guys getting better. And not only were they getting better, but seeing meetings, how they articulated and how they talked about the problem. Sometimes, some of them, it was maybe their second or third time around, but still, I could see them physically getting better and growing. When I looked in the mirror, I was still the same person I was when I went in, because I was still resisting, because I still had that pride and that arrogance. And the thing about the arrogance of me was that I had no reason to be arrogant or no reason to have that pride, because the things that I'd done, I was hugely ashamed and embarrassed of. I hadn't dealt with. I hadn't made amends to anybody. Treatment centre was an easy out for me at the time because I get away from all the people I owe money to. But anyway, I started to get my head around the programme, and after about 3 weeks resisting it all, I started to buy into it. And honestly, it was the best 3 months I've ever spent in my life. After 4 weeks, I come out, and all the people I owed money to, I went to them. And thankfully, 99% of them, well, 90% of them supported me and said that I told them to get the money, but they'd have to wait. And 90% of them were brilliant about it. Some people had to be paid off immediately, and my family were able to help me out with that. And I suppose in time, and the more I talked about it, the easier it got for me. And as I say, those 3 months are one thing, but it's the time you spend out of that. Because there's a safety net in the treatment centre, because you can't get to a book, you don't have to walk past a book, you don't have to interact with people day to day, you don't have to have your boy sitting beside you in the change room telling you that, you know, some team's even money this weekend, and that's a great bet. And you don't have to deal with that. But when you go back out in there, when you go back out into the real world, you have to deal with it. And not only do you have to deal with that, but you have to deal with the other issues that we all have to deal with day in, day out. And I suppose the treatment centre gave me the tools to sort of try and deal with all those things. And when eventually I started going to, well, it was at my meetings straight away, and when eventually I started to integrate myself back into things, I found it tough, but eventually things started to get easier. And my life now, today, resembles nothing like it was then, because when I was going around, and especially around the time when I was playing football, I wanted people to think I had everything. I wanted people to think that I was what they thought I was. That I had everything going for me. That I was the inter-county footballer who had a business and a car and girlfriends and all that sort of thing. I wanted people to think that. And if you're trying to portray that image all the time, serious pressure with it. Because I had to wear a mask full time. And the funny thing with me was that I could be in the depths of despair, having lost a huge amount of money, having fallen out with family, friends, whatever. And I could still meet you in the street. And honestly, I would almost give you a high five walking in the street just to show you how happy I was. Where in actual fact, inside I was absolutely eaten up. And inside, I was finding life very difficult. The day-to-day stuff, I was finding it very difficult to deal with. And I suppose the strange thing is, when I meet a lot of people now, a lot of guys who used to play against, the one thing they'll say to me, geez, you are cocky, arrogant, on the football field. And I don't correct them, because I don't want to correct them, but if they only knew that, in actual fact, I was complete opposite of that. But that's the image that I was putting out there. Because I wanted to be the big guy all the time. And when I went into a pub them days, I was just by myself, so I have to buy every drink. Even though I might not have a pot to piss in, I might have enough just to do that. But I'd walk in and I'd do that and I'd be gone again, because I wouldn't have any money left. But I'd have to do that because I wanted to portray to people how great I was. whereas in actual fact I was eaten up by addiction, disease, whatever you want to call it. You talk about getting beatings, like, and we get lots of beatings. I get lots of beatings as a footballer, and as an Armagh footballer to begin with, my early years it was par for the course. We used to get beat every year, but nothing beat me like Camlin beat me. And when I come down here and I talk about it, my story is not a sob story. My story is not a story that has an unhappy ending. My story is one of hope for people who are in the same situation or are going to be in the same situation as me, because I'm one of the lucky ones. I meet people every day who aren't as lucky as me. And I'll just finish with this, because when I met Tony Adams in Belfast that night, he asked me would I come over and do a little bit of work. He's a foundation, a charity over there, and he asked me would I do a few bits and pieces with him. So as part of that, I go on and do a little bit with Premier League clubs, not the first teams round, just junior squads, and we do a lot of rugby league clubs and stuff. But anyway, there's another guy who does it along with me, and his name's Andrew Brownrigg, and I can say his name because he's very open about what he's been through. But at 18 years of age, he got a £1 million contract with Norwich City, and he was due to play in the Premiership. And he made a couple of substitute appearances in his first year. He was also signed at the exact same time by another guy who got the exact same deal as him, and they ended up living in the same digs. And Andrew Brownrigg talks about his story about how he fell into drink and gambling and dabbling with drugs, and he felt as if when he got to Norwich City that he'd achieved everything he wanted to achieve, but yet he still didn't feel as if he really belonged in the top flight Premier League football. But anyway, just to bring your story on, about 3 months into his contract, or 3 months into his first season with Norwich, he said he couldn't take any more, and he pulled himself up on a rope, and he was hanging off the light switch, and his teammate, who got the exact same deal as him, come in, cut him down, and he lives to tell the tale. He never played top flight football or anything after that. But as he says, he's lucky because he got away with his life. And for me, that's one thing about addiction, and that's one thing about gambling and addiction in particular, is that it doesn't matter. And we talk a lot in the north about what religion you are. Or, you know, religion doesn't matter. Sex doesn't matter. Color doesn't matter. Nationality doesn't matter. It affects absolutely everybody. Age doesn't matter. And believe it or not, the biggest influx of people into Gamblers Anonymous nowadays, if you want to have a guess, women between the ages of 25 and 50. And when I first started to go to Gamblers Anonymous, I went to meetings in Galway when I was there, but I went to a meeting in Newry, and I used to go there 3 or 4 times a week, whatever it was. And every single time, we had 16 of a core group. Sometimes you're more, sometimes you're less, but let's say we had 16. Every one of those people in that room were aged between the ages of 18 and 70, men. Now, for those 16 people, there's at least 4 women at every meeting. And somebody asked me earlier about the availability of gambling, and that's one of the problems about the availability of gambling, is that for the housewife who's sitting at home playing bingo, that begins harmlessly. Same way as I walked into the boogies and I put a bet in the Grand National. Harmless as far as I was concerned. Not for me. That's where I ended up. For every 8 people that begin gambling, this is an American study, for every 8 people that begin gambling, 1 will gamble compulsively. And that's the stark realization of where we're at. And that's the huge problem we face, not just in this country, but in society. And we talk about the GAA, it's a huge problem within the GAA. The GAA people generally reflects what's going on in society as well. So But I have definitely rabbited on too long now, so I'll leave it at that. Do I ever go to Mass? Well, I would have been brought up. I would have been brought up going to Mass.
Go on to your family system.
Yes, absolutely. All the time.
You put on your family, your father, for your family having.
Do I put it down to my father? Absolutely not. Because whenever I told my mother about my gambling, my mother would have said to me, "Geez, we shouldn't have took you to the races on the 15th of August and all that sort of thing." But that was there. That was an outlet. It was a social thing. And for a lot of people sitting here who are listening to me saying, "Well, I put 20 quid in a horse at the weekend, or I put 20 quid in football teams." Fine. I'm not on a crusade to stop everybody gambling. I'm just talking about my experiences through gambling, and everybody's experiences are going to be different. But for the more people we introduce to gambling, the more compulsive gamblers we're going to have. But certainly, it would definitely not lay any blame at my mother or father's done. This is my problem. It resonated with me and started with me and finished with me.
She came into
that
because
of
the absolution.
Sorry? He would, but he wouldn't affect me.
Oisín, can I ask you, would you have any advice for parents of, say, like the under 14s or 16s, the vulnerable ages, for trainers or parents about kind of how to talk to their kids about it, or how to watch, or what signs to watch for, that they could support even before they get to the age?
Yeah, well, I think the big thing is just that educate, that's really all you can do. I think the other thing for young lads who have grown up who are going to, because that's how forthright young people are, I think, nowadays, is that they're going to say, "Well, actually, I am going to gamble." And if you are going to gamble, right, well then, how much do you think you can afford a week? Can you afford a fiver? Yeah, okay, I'll afford a fiver. Well, if you find yourself going above that, it's like I was earning whatever I was earning at my first job, maybe £200 a week or whatever it was, I was gambling 500. You know, so I was constantly gambling above my means, and I think that's the thing. And the other thing is that if you have somebody who you feel within the house has a problem, absolutely ask them the question. You know, do you feel as if you have a problem? Because initially what you'll hear is, "No, I don't." But eventually, you're the person. No matter how many times you get rebuked, the person that they'll come back to whenever they feel as if, you know, they're ready to talk about it is you. So. Well, you can get on the phone now, or anything.
We might let you drop and we do questions and answers, but that's all right, Oisín.
I'll give Jeanette a little break there now. So first of all, Oisín, just to say thanks a million for coming to Carlow Library. We're delighted to have you. And I suppose, as you say, it wasn't a sob story. It was a story of hope. And I think that was the message that came through loud and clear. So I think, just to say thanks very much for your time. You travelled a long distance to be here with us this evening. And we really do appreciate it. So I'll ask for another round of applause. My colleague and the library team, Jonathan and Martin, but Jeanette organised the event this evening, and she put her heart and soul into it, as she does with everything, and did it with good grace. So just ask you for a clap for Jeanette. And we're delighted in the library to have worked with the GAA on this occasion, and Benny spoke on their behalf this evening, so thanks to Benny as well. I'll be very brief, because we might, if Oisín doesn't mind, answering a few questions from the floor, but I just want to give a small barefaced plug to a collection of books that we have in the library. It's called Mind Matters, and it's a collection of books that deals with issues such as addiction and anxiety, depression and so on. So a lot of the details on that collection are on our website, and we have a variety of books to look at this evening as well. And we would like to offer free membership to anybody who's interested in joining here this evening. So again, just say thanks to Oisín, and if anybody else has any further questions, please. please feel free to ask.
Except for David.
For a matter we watched many, many times on television and in person. I've really got a few broken hearts many, many times. It amazes me to know why you were in this cocoon of problems and monies and this, that and the other. You must have a lot of friends that were keeping you going. But the other point was, where did the football come from? Like, you were in trouble, you owed money here, you owed money there, you were probably working, you were keeping away from your family. Where did McGrory and the Kieran's and all these men who were managing it and the guys you were playing with, where were they in all of this? And how in the name of God did you produce so much brilliance and excellence and whatever you like to call it, all those superlatives on the field?
Well, I suppose, I don't know which part down to first, but
sorry.
I suppose the thing about breaking your hearts is that you're breaking everybody's heart with the ways I play. Well, I suppose, as I said, there was two boys that I played with in particular, and that, two McEntees who I grew up with, and we soldiered long and many today, but they would have said it to me because they were my closest friends. They would have said it to me. Managers didn't say it to me. And another thing, though, and this may explain, you know, where we were at that time, but when I went into treatment in 2005, I got two phone calls from football related people. Okay. The first one was from Joe Kernan, who asked me when I was going to be back. That was the only question he asked me when he got on the phone. And my club manager, who was actually a cousin of mine, who asked me when I was going to be back. Now, you can say that's not a dig against Joe Kernan, or that's not a dig against my club manager. But that, for me, is where we were at that time as far as mental health. It wasn't talked about. There was a stigma involved in it, and I was part of that stigma at that time, and that was something that they didn't want to address or talk about. And I suppose for me at that time, I felt that was fine. I felt that was okay because I didn't know any different. You know, my answer to them was, I'll be back in 6 weeks or whatever it was. My answer to them was, I'll be back in, not for the next match, but at the start of the league or whatever it was. And I remember coming back. I remember coming back into that change room. I was afraid of my life walking into that change room. Because some of the guys in there knew because I told them where I was. Some of the other ones I didn't tell them. Because I didn't feel the need to tell them. Because as much as the boys I played along with, they didn't need to know. It was the guys that were that I was friendly with and that I felt as if they needed to know. I told them. The other ones I didn't. And that was why I was so scared. And I often thought about just coming out in the change room and just telling everybody where I was, but I decided against that. I don't know why I decided against it, but I decided against it. It was a lot of the players that did know said that I shouldn't feel the need to do that. So I didn't, and maybe it's something that I should have done, but I just think, even though it's not that long ago, it's only 10 years ago, you know, it hadn't really been recognised in the GAA. It's only in the last number of years that we're actually talking about it, and we're actually taking the stigma away from it. I mean, so many other people, like Niall McNamee, you only have to row from yourselves. I mean, he's another person who has talked about it. I actually had him in my own club recently, and he talked about it, and we had our under 16, 18s and senior players there, and they all sat down, I guess, and they listened to him, and they were intently listening to his story. Tony Adams has talked about it. There's so many more people now talking about lifting the stigma away from it, and we're dealing with it probably that little bit better, because when we talk about something, we start to deal with it. And I don't know if there's any other stance to your question, but essentially that one was going on as far as other people didn't see it. As far as expressing myself on the football field,
again, that was my wee thing, that I was able to get away from that. I was able to get away from gambling and all of those things. And push, try and push that to the back of my mind. Now, there was one occasion, I can't remember exactly what year it was, 03, 04. We were going in and we were playing in the Ulster final. At that time, Ulster finals were Crow Park. And on the way in, I got a message. And the message said to watch myself today, that I was going to be got. This is from people that I had borrowed money from, that I shouldn't have borrowed from. And I was afraid and I was scared, but also I knew that I was affecting everybody in that gym. And not on the bus. We were on the bus at the thing. I knew I was affecting 30 other people on that bus who were doing everything in their power to try and win another All Ireland. And I was affecting that, you know. And I watched back in particular the video of that game. I don't watch too many videos, but I watched the video of that game, and I actually look as white as a ghost playing the game. And that was because that was one of those games where I couldn't get that out of my head, because I felt a real proper threat. I felt that this had started to affect the one thing in my life that, you know, I sort of have sacrosanct. If you consider everything in my life is sort of in a mess, and there's one wee thing, football, that makes sense, and that I feel comfortable there. And probably that's why I felt every time I went out in the football field, like it was a release, you know, that I could express myself.
What advice would you give to young compulsive gamblers that are looking to stop?
Stop. That's the first thing, and go to meetings, get to meetings. You won't stop, you can stop, but you won't stay stopped by yourself. I don't know if there's any meetings in Carlow. I'm pretty sure I remember seeing them on the website. Because I've spoke to a few people from down around this area. So there's definitely meetings in Kilkenny, there's meetings in Athay, there's meetings in anywhere.
Carlow Monday night,
8 o'clock. Dublin, all around this area, there's lots and lots of meetings. So get the meetings, because without the meetings, you don't have a chance. I suppose initially get somebody to look after your finances, just like I did. Get somebody who, especially for a young person, I mean, somebody you trust, like a parent or whatever, and hand all your stuff over to them, so you don't have the firepower to go gambling and get the meetings. Because the most important thing, and just try and be honest. Because I would have loved it, and I said this earlier, that if I just had to tell one person, it was not that I would have stopped gambling, but it certainly would have made my life a lot easier just to be able to share it with one person. And I have the trust and courage in myself to share it with one person. No, I can't have a bet. It is a good question. It is a good question, because the funny thing is that people were afraid to talk about gambling to me, and now all of a sudden, 10 years later, are going, you know, they're starting to talk to me about it like it's like I'm cured, like I'm over that, like I can start again now, like I'll have a wee bet. It doesn't work like that for me, because I'm called a compulsive gambler, and it's complete absence for me. I won't buy a lot of ticket, I won't buy a scratch. I never did that anyway, but I wouldn't do any of that. It has to be complete absence for me. For the first 6 to 12 months, it was a complete roller coaster ride. I was just really, really holding on just to try and get through that period, getting to as many meetings as I could, and just trying to live the program. And after that, things certainly got easier. And now it's not something that none of the people in my circle gamble. I have a wife and two kids, I don't have time to go gambling. I really don't have any money now. And it's just not something that, my life is so far removed from that, from where I was 10 years ago, you know, that it's not something I think about. The only thing about that I would say is that it's not something that I would get cocky about either. It's something that's always there in the back of my head, and that's why I was saying, like, this for me is as good as a meeting for me, because I'm talking about it and it brings me back to where I was and where it brought me. So therefore, as a result of that, it helps me, you know.
Can you watch Champion?
Well, see, the thing, and that's the other question I didn't answer, but the thing about Cheltenham and that was that I wasn't gambling for the love of the horses. You know, the sport of kings and all that. That bypassed me. I would be as happy gambling on the 11-19 at Monmouth or the 8:30 on a Saturday night at Wolverhampton. That's the way I was. Cheltenham was just another way I could gamble. People often say, and especially shortly after, you know, people started to realise what my problem was, they would say, you know, this is a tough week for you if it's Cheltenham week, or this is a tough day for you if it's the Grand National. No tougher than any other day. No tougher than any other day.
You feel the peer pressure. I heard you say there once, especially in the dressing room, someone said about a match somewhere or other, that'd be a good bet. But do you feel there's a bit of peer pressure from your colleagues in the dressing room or from club members in relation to placing bets, or is it coming into the sport, especially the GAA, in relation to, say, that dreaded thing of match fixing or drawing a game for the sake of a few pounds? I know there are awkward questions.
No, it's not at all. I mean, the Armagh team, we had a culture of gambling. We gambled on a Saturday on the way up to Dublin. I mean, we used to be in Dublin. At that stage, we were in Dublin every other week. If it wasn't an actual game, it was preparation for a game or it was whatever. And we used to gamble, but the key thing here is that we were gambling on the way up the road in the bus. It was people throwing in a fiver or a tenner, and nobody was gambling above their means in the bus. It was when we got to the hotel and the boys were playing 9 holes of golf or going to the gym or pool or whatever, I was stuck in my room, you know, on the phone, I was gambling. You know, and I think that's the difference for me. As far as match fixing goes, it takes 15 players, you know, to, you know, it's very difficult, very difficult to fix a match. But, like, it was something that crossed my mind at times whenever things got really bad. You know, there's no point in saying any different. And
I thought I felt that you saying that you felt that you were an obstacle to your team going forward because of that check that you got, the text message.
Well, I just think that one of the statistics say that for every person who's in addiction, whether that be drink, drugs, or gambling, that it affects 10 other people. I mean, my immediate family was 33, you know, that's brothers, sisters, nieces, nephews. And then I had 40 gays on the bus relying on me. Not relying on me per se, but we were relying on each other, and I was one of those players. So I wasn't just affecting them and my family, but like, you gotta think that You gotta say to yourself, if you're gonna be honest with yourself, and I found it very difficult to be honest with myself, but if I would be honest with myself, you'd have to say that I was having some sort of effect on what was going on, you know, what way we were playing on a Sunday. You know, so that's the only thing. And when I meet up my teammates, and we meet up every year, or we used to meet up every year, I suppose maybe every 2 years now, and we sit around and we have a drink or whatever, and we'd be talking about, do you remember this and you remember that? And I'm thinking, was I on this team or not? Because I don't remember half of the stuff they're on, but I think I was in my room gambling the full game, you know, or I was on my phone or whatever. But if I don't have the same memories as they do. I suppose that's a bit of a regret, but again, I don't have that many regrets because I am where I am now, you know.
Are your family or did they feel like they should have known, you know, like you came from a small place and you had a high profile, you know, obviously people would be saying, oh, there, you know, he's in the bookies again, or, you know, did they feel, I suppose, guilt that they didn't know or know the extent of it?
Well, I suppose first question was, I was surprised, you know, I was surprised, and the answer to that was that I had two brothers who would have said it to me a couple of times. So they weren't overly surprised, but they were surprised at the extent of it. My sisters were absolutely flabbergasted. Because I was the youngest in the house and spoiled and all those things, and they couldn't play the football and they couldn't see me doing any wrong, you know. So I would safely say there was a huge amount of disappointment, even though they tried really hard to hide it. They got their heads around it pretty quickly. They would have used Gammonon, and anybody who doesn't know what Gammonon is, it's support for the family members of people who are in addiction, or Al-Anon families affected by alcohol. So they would have used that facility and went to get a huge amount of support. And it's not something they stuck at, but they weren't living with me every day of the week, so I suppose they just wanted to get their head around and understand where I was at and hear from other people who had the experiences. So I think that was something that really stood to them. And as I say, they started to get their head around it. But I've one sister in particular, one sister who looked after all the finances, so she was very much looking after that end of things. So every time I'd come home from work, hand her the money, she'd let me know every so often where we stood and different things like that. Because at the end, I got a loan guarantor for £100,000 to pay off the immediate debts that I had. So she was paying off that. But I had another sister who used to continuously come back to me every week with another question. Remember the time that was that, you know, remember the time you asked me for money for the open heart surgery or whatever lay I'd made up? She'd say, was that lay? Yeah, it was lay. And every time she'd come back to me, I'd say, yeah, that was a lay.
Did you mind her asking?
No, I didn't actually, because I knew that it was helping her get it sorted out in her head as well. And it was sort of helping everybody, and that's the thing. After a certain amount of time, the more I talked about it, the more we were all able to deal with it, you know.
Was there any one part where, like, you thought, like, Jesus, I mean, this is the deepest hole I'm in, like, I'm in, all this dark
hole? Yeah, I was in a lot of dark holes, and I'm not just saying this willy-nilly, but I would have had suicidal thoughts. I would have thought, what's the best way out for me now, you know? And taking my own life was right up at the top of the agenda at one stage, you know, because I didn't see a way out. I didn't see another way out. And again, just that whole asking for help, for me, that was a weakness. Like, I didn't want to show that because I was still full of that pride, you know. That was the way I felt when I was in those deep holes. But instead of, you know, I suppose at that stage asking for help, I hook, scam, steal, whatever, in order to get that money to get that next bet. Because as I was saying earlier, I was only one bet away from sorting out all these problems, you know, or so I thought. Yeah.
Oisin, I'd like to compliment you on absolutely fantastic there tonight in Bearing World. Just want to ask, did the GAA organization, I know this has only come in relevant lately, this maybe gambling, and it's probably becoming a big problem. Did you get much support from the GA, say, from right from the top down or from the bottom up, or was it yourself that had to do
it? I didn't get any support at all from the GA, and again, that's not to have a go at anybody, that's just where we were at the time. And the thing is now, and I'm overjoyed to see it, is that me or somebody similar to me with the same problem now is open to so many lanes of support and layers of support and different support, and whatever's needed is there for players. Certainly at the county level, you know, anyway, and hopefully that's filtering down into clubs with the good work that's going on with health and wellbeing officers. So
I know you have no crystal ball, Oisin. Would you think that it's a major problem, starting to become a major problem, maybe in clubs as well?
Literally, and I might have said this, well, I spoke to her on the phone, but literally there isn't a week goes by where I don't get at least two phone calls from people within the GAA who are in absolute dire straits with gambling. And I know this, the problem is widespread. And again, it goes from down to, I do a talk every year in Blackrock College with Leavers, and this is the first year ever, but they actually had two people in that college who actually went for treatment this year, and that's in their last year of college. So, our last year at school, not even college, on the way to college. So, it's getting younger and younger, and the problem's getting deeper and deeper. And we don't have, unfortunately, we don't have the facilities to deal with it in this country at the moment.
Is there a role for government to take action to close or restrict? I was delighted when I saw the letter, and he was a government minister many years ago, Ivan Yates. And I was one of the people who were delighted. He had a shop in this town. And because he was who he was, with a high profile Wexford man, young people went in to see him. And as you said, you go into the bookie office now and you're treated well. The first thing you see is the coffee machine. Or the first thing you see is the soft seat. And you see a number of guys having a great crack. All with themselves. Fellas who worked, fellas who are retired and they go down the back of the horse and whatever. And Jesus, it's a very comfortable establishment in these places. So there must be a role for government to restrict the avenues for gambling and whatever. Like young people in this town at the moment, talking about 10, they're going in at 5 and 6, 7 or 8 years of age into bookie offices at the moment, walking in. And I'm just asking you, Oisín, is there a role, and if there is, what is the role for the authorities or government to restrict the lines of that are open to young people at the moment?
Well, I just think, you know, you hit on it. One of the things that we can be a lot more rigid about is what age we gamble at. You know, I think, you know, when can you make a reasonable decision as a young adult, you know, whether I can gamble or not? But I think the bigger issue is not government. I think the bigger issue is society, how we stigmatize it, how we deal with it, how we educate it. I mean, there's nothing being done in schools. I mean, I go around different schools when I'm asked, but I have a job as well, and like, for me, I think it doesn't have to be me, but why not hand pick people from society who have faced their demons, put them in the schools and let them talk to people from 14 years of age, and you know what, it might only resonate with two people in every school, but isn't that something? At least we're doing something proactive rather than reactive. You know, we react to things, and if you're looking for the government to do something about it, I mean, I've seen some of the figures on the money that they get revenue wise from bookmakers in this country. It's scandalous. I mean, I was talking to Paddy Power earlier, who I think made 10 million in all the shops last year and half a billion online. You know, so if people think that, you know, the government aren't doing well out of the tax on that, then, you know. So I think I'd like to take it away from out of our hands and let us as society be proactive about it. The only thing is that all we ever do is talk about these things. You know, we could sit here tonight and we can talk about it, but nothing ever seemed to be done because the government have too much of a vested interest in what's going on, you know, and they're not going to face the problem, and they're not going to piss people off when they've got a word.
Well, Donald, what you've spoken about, and you made a comment that we haven't got resources in this country. Where is it working well in other countries, and what are they doing to get to see them here?
Well, I was just talking earlier about a new initiative that has arrived. Well, it's not new, it's actually not that new, it's years old. But just the government in both the south, the north, and well, to a lesser extent in England and Scotland. But there's a thing called CBD, which is cross-border directive, which basically means that if you have a problem here, you can go and get it dealt with in Scotland, and the government, believe it or not, should pay for that. Now, that sounds crazy, but I was telling them a bit of a, I was telling these guys a bit of a facility in Scotland, and there's 100 bed occupancy in it. This is for drugs, eating disorders, alcohol, gambling, and of those 100 beds, there's 80 people from Holland in it, and they are all being paid for by the government at £800 a day. They're a government who have bought into it. Well, I don't know how to fund that. I mean, I'm sure to fund it through tax or what. Well, I don't know. I'm not that great on the economy or anything like that, lucky enough. But I don't know how to fund that, but that's what they do. This is a law, this is European law, and our government are resisting it. It's a fight. Every single person you get from this country to Scotland or England or wherever is a constant fight. Now, I know there's a court case pending, I think, which is going to force their hand on this, but the reaction of the governments, both north and south, has been absolutely scandalous on it. Because it's a thing that's going on Europe-wide. And when I say we don't have the facilities, we're not the only country that doesn't have the facilities, lots of countries, but if the government were to buy into it, we could have people being treated, you know, in other countries. And we could have, you know, we only have, I don't know exactly how many beds we have in this country, but I know that there wouldn't be scratching the surface of how many we need. No, I'm quite sure, as you say, it did affect me, and I'm quite sure that I can pick specific points where it affected me, and specific points where I didn't have the games that I probably thought I should have, and performed at a level that I should have because this thing was niggling in the back of my head. But it's a very difficult question to answer, you know, how much more was in the tank, but I'm sure it was more because the other side of it is, as you say, like, you know, not eating, sleeping, but the other side of it was that when boys were going to the gym, I was like, I don't know whether you can tell or not, but I was avoiding those, you obviously weren't, but I was avoiding those sessions, and even a simple thing like recovery, you know, on the Monday night after a game or whatever, recovery, I was in the boogies recovering. No, it was never in a game, and I think probably in some times that sort of happened. You know, you have a big game coming up, and everybody's talking to me on the Tuesday and Thursday night, going, "Jesus, big one, it could be 80." And I'd be thinking, "Jesus, get me away from here, let's get a bet on." You know, and so, you know, I don't mean lighthearted about it, but it did sort of take away the all that focus that was so, like, some of the guys I played with were like, you know, some of the boys I play with, like, they just had blinkers on. Like, it was like, you towards the night before you play an all and finally go through you, straight through you in a football field, like, you know, and yeah, Francie and Keane McGeaney and McGrain and Marsden and all those boys and McIntyre's, like, there was no let up with them. It was go all the time. So I wasn't like that, you know. And I know it takes different characters to make up a team, but I would say that I was attracting a little bit from that, you know. So just those sessions that really I was missing out and that I should have been doing, you know, that was the big thing probably.
When you tell your children, what age
did you tell your children? One of them's 3 and the other one's 9 months. So I will tell them because I'm going to have to tell them, you know. I don't know what stage that would be at. Myself and my wife talked about that the other night, because my wife is somebody who didn't know me when I was gambling, luckily enough. Well, she wouldn't be my wife, but she didn't know me when I was gambling, and we only met afterwards, you know, to say that after treatment, just stay away from relationships for a couple of years. So it was probably a couple of years after I came out of treatment that I met her and got married, two kids, and it's funny, that's something that I didn't think of. You know, when I was writing the book and I was, you know, talking about it, it's something you don't think of, what effect it would have on your kids, but it's something real. But I'd rather be talking to them about that than talking to them about why I'm still out there ruining everybody's lives, you know. So it's something that I'll have to address, but I'm a bit of breathing space before I have to do that.
Well, you just a question, during all this and all the years that you were gambling, and you mentioned about around 20,000 to get a bet, what was your darkest day? Was it a smaller bet that you couldn't afford to go home, or was it, what was the darkest day that struck you and said?
Probably my darkest day, or my darkest sort of period was, I took a pub on in Cavan, and the pub that we knew quite well, it was busy. I wasn't gambling as much as I had been, because I was very much into what was going on, and it was a busy time of the year and all that sort of thing, and the pub had actually done really, really well, and there was a few pounds in the bank, and bills were paid, and I think I had 66,000 in the bank or something after a couple of months with all the bills paid and everything. It was over, I took it over before Christmas, so it was a very manic time of year. And I went on a gambling binge for a week and I lost every single penny, and I was down another 20 or 30,000 or something. But, and again, I apologize for mentioning figures. Figures don't really matter. None of that money was mine. I think that's something that I have to say as well. Is the money that I borrowed wasn't mine, and a lot of the money I gambled wasn't mine. But that was probably the darkest period, because I then sort of really started raising. So going from thinking it was harmless to being in denial to realizing what my problem was, and when I realized what my problem was, realizing that I knew what I had to do, but I couldn't do it, and that was probably the darkest thing for me. I won't be talking about it anymore today. I had a lot of false dawns, but I never actually had told anybody. So I had a lot of false dawns, and I would have tried to stop myself and quit myself, and it just never happened. I might quit for a day or 2 days, or maybe even stretch that out to 3 days, but I couldn't stop and stay stopped. But I suppose I tried a couple of times, realistically, but not a concerted try, and not something that I thought was ever going to last. But the first time that I actually opened up to somebody, to say when I broke down that time, that was the one and only time that I really sort of tried to address it. You know.
Thanks to everybody in the room, to Oisin for his honesty and for his frankness and for his fantastic advice, and for coming to Carlow to share his story and his brutal honesty again, and give us in the room some insight into the realistic things that go on in the head of somebody with an addiction. Again, as Deirdre said, for anybody that's here tonight that's interested, we're going to offer free membership to the library for anyone that's here. And the collection Deirdre was talking about, The Mind Matters, is actually just inside the showroom if anyone wants to have a quick peek. There's also a good selection of the GAA and the training books inside. And you know, if you know somebody with a problem or whatever, or if you do want to refer them to the library, there's always a case of, like Oisin said, I don't want anyone to know. So we have a couple of machines in the library for use as well. They're called RFID, they're self-service. So if somebody wants to come in and get a book and they didn't want to face someone at the counter, or they're embarrassed, or their parent or a friend wanted to take out something and look for a bit of support about how they could help or approach a loved one or a family member, the machines are self-service, so you can come in, join up, take out your book, and nobody knows your business. So just to let you know, that offer is there. But look, the main thing tonight is the main man himself. So thanks everybody for coming.